Todd Haynes makes unconventional, passionate, radically intelligent films. To say he's no stranger to controversy is an understatement. A quick look at his filmography reveals why each new Todd Haynes film is eagerly awaited by his fans. Superstar, the Karen Carpenter story, uses Barbie dolls to tell the story of the life and death of Karen Carpenter and was the subject of a lawsuit by Richard Carpenter. All copies of the film were ordered, recalled, and destroyed, making it a cult classic. His first feature, Poison, was attacked by conservatives and Christians who said it was pornographic for its depiction of gay sex. It went on to win the Grand Jury Prize at the Sundance Film Festival and is now considered a seminal work of the new queer cinema. Safe told the story of a woman, played by Julianne Moore, suffering from a breakdown caused by a mysterious illness. Many thought the film a metaphor for the AIDS crisis. In Velvet Goldmine, he combines the visual style of 60s, 70s art films and his love for glam rock music to describe a fictional rock star's rise and fall. Far From Heaven, inspired by the 1950s films of Douglas Sirk, is about a Connecticut housewife, Julianne Moore again, who discovers that her husband is gay and has an affair with her Afro-American gardener. A critical and box office success, it won 4 Academy Awards and was hailed as a breakthrough for independent film. With I'm Not There, Haynes returned to the theme of musical legend, portraying Bob Dylan via 6 different actors, one of whom was a cross-gender Kate Blanchett. In 2011, Haynes directed Mildred Pierce, a 5-hour miniseries for HBO starring Kate Winslet in the title role. His new feature film, Carol, with Kate Blanchett again, premiered at the Cannes International Film Festival 2015 to rave reviews and won Best Actress for Rooney Mara. Todd Haynes appears in conversation tonight with San Francisco International Film Society Executive Director Noah Cowan. Before we welcome them, let's take a look at clips that bookend Todd Haynes' career to date, Superstar, followed by Carol.
Who else has heard this tape?
RCA, Columbia, Decca.
And they all turned you down?
They said it wouldn't sell.
That hard rock's in.
And wholesome's out.
What's your name?
Me? Karen.
Karen, I like your voice. Tell you the truth, I think you kids have really got something here. Karen and Richard Carpenter. Just a couple of kids next door. Now listen to me. You kids are young, fresh, and it'll just be up to me to make young and fresh a happening thing.
And your muse.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm starved. Bon appetit. What do you do on Sundays?
Nothing in particular. What do you do?
Oh, nothing lately. I mean, if you'd like to come visit me sometime, you're welcome to. At least there's some pretty country around where I live. Would you like to come visit me this Sunday?
Yes.
What a strange girl you are.
Why?
Flung out of space.
Ladies and gentlemen, Noah Cowan and Todd Haynes.
Todd, welcome to San Francisco.
Thank you, Noah.
So it was fun watching that Superstar clip. I think we met when that film played at the Toronto International Film Festival a few moons ago.
Yes.
And it's part of its short public run before Richard Carpenter decided to end its life.
Right.
Which
was imminent.
We knew. You knew it was happening.
Yes.
It's just interesting. The film really comes out of this kind of interesting early life of yours, which sort of seems to play through the films and seems to thematically, kind of really sort of reinforce itself as you go from work to work. You grew up in the suburbs of Los Angeles. The suburbs and suburban life become a kind of constant refrain through a lot of your work. Studied semiotics at Brown, and that sort of deconstructive tendency appears throughout the work as we go through it. But just to start off, I wanted to, because we kind of did that kind of bookend of the sort of earliest and the later work, do you still feel as though you're motivated by a lot of the same elements as you were at the beginning of your career, where you felt as though there's been a great shift?
I do think it's always changing. I think in recent years, I've entered into a phase that maybe resembles that of more directors than I, more common among directors than I ever felt previously, which is just, opening yourself up to stuff in development. Scripts that come to me, for a while there I was like, no, I only develop and only write my own stuff. And it's actually, sort of ushered in an interesting new phase for me and one that I've enjoyed and learned a lot from. That said, I can't completely deny that I don't hold a certain audacity and a certain kind of radical desire to sort of challenge. I hold that up to myself, in my more mature years as something that defined me, something that really established a career that I never even really set out to make for myself. Like, I didn't ever really imagine viable a feature filmmaking career. Mm-hmm. And my, orientation at Brown and studying art and semiotics and I had a lot of really great examples of experimental filmmakers who had academic lives and who could make their work separately. And it was a lot to do with certain circumstances and timing and sort of cultural events that propelled, Superstar into visibility. And then following that, my first feature, Poison. But interestingly, Superstar is just a film that is hard for me not to return to because it encompasses so many of the themes that I would later play out in feature filmmaking, from films about women, mm-hmm. but all in one very concise little package. Films about women.
You haven't quite returned to doll puppetry?
I haven't quite. Although there's moments in Goldmine,
yep.
and actually a little bit in a film I'm developing now. Okay. But issues of disease, issues of women, and issues of pop culture and music, and as well as in this, conceptual framework that exposes the sort of language of filmmaking and how our emotions are often constructed and how our orientation as spectators are oriented, So I still learn a lot from that first film.
Are there like a canon of films? Do you have is there a DVD library when you started there really weren't DVDs, but is there a kind of collection of films that continues to inspire you, maybe even beyond films, of films and books that sort of live with you and become repeat inspirations?
Definitely. I mean, I of course I like to try to see new work and see what's going on now, but I can't not continue to go back to classic Hollywood filmmaking and directors who I think even European directors like Fassbinder, who paid very close attention to certain generic movements and moments in the Hollywood tradition, and looked at it from critical perspectives and saw how much radical work was actually happening within a studio system. You know, I think there are times where you just to behold work by Alfred Hitchcock and to realize that the popular instinct and the subversive instinct could exist so with such uniformity and with such, you know, complicity, you know, is a remarkable thing and something that only could happen in this strange industry that combines commerce, dreams, desire, you know, anticipation of trends, and a reflecting back of what our culture is, I guess.
Absolutely. So I think we're going to get into the next batch of movies. Your first two films are, many ways, sort of shaped the beginning of American independent film culture. They are timed to the rise of the Sundance Film Festival. They both find great success there. A great actress emerges from the second safe. You know, at that time, one of our great American actresses, and they still retain this power, great power to influence young filmmakers. Poison, which is the first clip we'll see, is sort of noted for its, you know, kind of complex structure, and sort of safe for its kind of expressionist beauty. I'm going to talk about those in a second. Let's roll some clips.
By the time I was 16 years old, I was notorious as a kid with a terrific knack for theft. Foster homes would no longer take me, and I was sent to the boys' reformatory of Baton. There, in the counterfeit world of men among men, I found my true family. At Baton, I was astounded by the discovery that each male had a male of his own, and that the world of force and manly beauty loved in that way within itself, from link to link. It was from then on, when they merged in shadow, that each group offered me a puzzle. The stiff, silent males possessed the violence of love, and my life study would be to find it. Sixteen years had passed when the maximum security prison of Fontenot brought me face to face with my deliverance. Jack Bolton, age 28, 175 pounds, 75 inches, formerly a captive of Baton.
What do you got there, honey?
My coloring book.
Can I see? Oh, she's gotten so big.
Barbara, this is delicious.
You know, we haven't really talked lately. How you doing?
Good. I've just been a little...
Look at it, it's you.
Oh, yeah.
Under the weather.
Right.
Look at it, she's a princess.
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's very good. It's very realistic.
Ladies, we are now opening the big present. Please come in.
Okay. Here we come.
Mona Lisa, let's go home.
Look at the big present, okay?
Coincidentally,
you thought he was? Yeah.
You ever seen? What did you see it? God, I haven't seen it yet. Oh,
you have to.
God. Oh, this fancy wrapping. Yeah. He holds it too much.
Come on, don't be polite.
Oh, I'm trying.
Oh, that's exactly the one I wanted. Oh.
There's a package with the wheels inside, and they go on really easily. You just screw them in. Even you can do it.
Mommy?
Oh, that's great, Watson.
I'm not gonna wash it. Well, right.
Carol?
But it can be done.
Right?
Yeah, thank you.
Carol.
What's going on?
I don't know. Carol?
Oh, my God. Linda, what happened?
She can't breathe.
Caroline, call her house. Someone should call her doctor. And Jennifer, could you get some water, please?
Just try to relax, okay?
Calm down. It's okay. It's all gonna be fine. Just relax.
Amazing. Still think that's one of the most powerful moments of recent cinema. It's an incredible piece of work.
Wes Anderson, who we just lost, said it was the scariest movie of 1995, which meant a great deal to me.
It does mean a great deal. Let's start with Poison. So around the time it came out, there was also a kind of enormous explosion of really interesting cinema. Most of it, but not exclusively, by gay men, and it was known as the queer new wave, and took a radical aesthetic approach. There was a lot of political anger in the face of the sort of ignorance around the AIDS epidemic and the larger echelons of the political establishment, and a lot of frank sexuality being put on screen. It was always kind of a loose group, I think. I mean, there were New York filmmakers, there were LA filmmakers, there was even some Europeans thrown in. I think Derek Jarman even got to be included, even though he was towards the end of his career at the time. But it did feel like something very special and important was actually happening. And Poison, in many ways, was the sort of defining film that sort of began people speaking about that there was something new happening. How comfortable are you with being sort of talking about that as a group of filmmakers and as a movement?
Well, I'm extremely comfortable, and you know, it was Ruby Ridge who coined the phrase at a Sundance gathering in '92. But you know, there was something happening in the world at the time. And it created, and it was AIDS, and so one, you know, me in my 20s, having just moved to New York City, and you know, getting involved in AIDS activism, and you know, there are rare times in life, I think, when. For artists, for you know, documentarians, for historians, journalists, where a certain public crisis creates a demand for reaction, and sometimes that can take on overt political motivations and outcomes, and sometimes it's very much a personal expression of some response, you know? And that was really what was happening. And so it focused a lot of energies. It made necessary a lot of work. And in that regard, it was an honor and a humbling and overwhelming period to be a part of and a learning experience. And to sort of be swept up into it with Poison that also became the target, the sort of inadvertent target of the far right, and sort of fighting parallel battles that it was never intended to really wage, you know. But it all felt like we were in a sort of wave of response to what was happening. I mean, you know, in 1986, Ronald Reagan, the president, uttered the word AIDS for the first time. There were already 24,000 Americans dead, seven times the number of people who died at the World Trade Center. I mean, it's a phenomenal, that's not that long ago, you know? Mm. And so the level of outrage, the level of urgency was prevalent. And so, yes, I'm proud to have been part of that period.
Ruby Rich, are you here tonight?
We hoped you might be here. Yeah, I have a little quote from her, actually, along the lines you're talking about, which is sort of the flip side of it. She's sort of talked about this idea of, let me see if I get it right, maverick sexuality as this powerful anti-establishment social force. And sort of looking back at how, obviously, the far right and the NEA controversy, but just generally, it was perceived as a really risque, you know, film in so many ways, and trespassive around its sort of portrayal of sexuality. With everywhere we've come here, with the social changes we've seen, you know, certainly over the last few years, and you know, seeing gay sexuality being discussed very openly on network television and stuff like that, how much of an effect do you think that radicalism and that moment of cinema actually had on this social change, this quite extraordinary social change that's happened here?
Oh, I think it had a tremendous effect. I mean, most pointedly and intent with the full intention was for it to affect changes in research and development of drugs around HIV, and it did. And the whole site-specific acute forms of activism that it engendered were effective and empowering. But what followed was and fairly rapidly, I think, on the tail of at least the immediate crisis of the AIDS epidemic, was a different commitment to the representation of queer people in film and television. And I sort of suspected from the start, from that period, which felt like things were moving initially not quickly enough, but then things started to change and protease inhibitors were developed and the whole cycle of that illness and the mortality of people changed around HIV. But I was asked by The Nation, who was doing an issue about queer representation, what I thought, I think it was a question about what would be the next 10 years like in gay representation. And I sort of thought, I wrote something at the time that was sort of like, I imagine that it will be not that different from the sort of aspects of the civil rights era, yeah, where the kind of, you know, cultivation of sort of acceptable images, the Sidney Poitierization, for lack of a better word, of the sort of Rupert Everett equivalent of, yeah, the perfect gay best friend in 90s films, you know, who was very domestic, you know, you could take him into your living room and everybody would be thrilled and all of that. And of course, all of that would ultimately lead to, I think, a visibility and a saturation of gay representation that has affected our legislative lives, our real existence. It's also changed the whole level of what, I guess, at the beginning, in the poison era, a kind of activist position and a sort of radical position and a kind of, you know, I looked at the work of Jean Genet for inspiration, and he was somebody who was deeply invested in the notion of the criminality of homosexuality. And it empowered and sharpened his critique of dominant society. And I think at the time we felt something akin to that, you know. So it's an interesting, fascinating, and a lot of this has come up around Carol, my recent film, which, you know, of course, you look back at the early 1950s and what lesbian love had to face. And we are living in a very, very different world, and thank God. But there was also something really radical about falling in love outside of a known world of representation and outside of language. And you almost felt like you were inventing that love while it was happening. And there's something romantic and
beautiful,
you know,
about it.
Yeah. Corrosive about that.
And corrosive?
In a good way.
Nice. Let's talk about actresses. Obviously, that's a pretty great example of the quite a remarkable facility that you have in eliciting quite extraordinary performances by some of the kind of most interesting actresses working today. Kind of starts with Safe, though. This relationship with Julianne Moore, then you go on to work with her again in another incredible performance in Far From Heaven. And I guess the first question is really, how do you do it? You know, how do you actually work with Kate Winslet and Mildred Pierce, probably the best work of her career, her extraordinary career. What's the secret? What's the secret to actually eliciting these extraordinary performances from these women?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, thank you. But it starts with picking really, really amazing women. And some of them are hard to find. But I do think it also starts with believing that, you know, women's stories and women's experiences are not just as important as any other experiences of men's experiences, but if anything, they actually, you know, that women's films about women are almost by definition non-escapist films. They're films that, even when they're wonderful frothy comedies of Carol Lombard in the 30s, or great eras of where women's films were made quite prevalently in the industry, and a female audience was counted on to make that possible. Still, the sort of complexity of sexual politics, the unique roles women have to uphold social institutions like the family and maternity, and the trade-offs and the issues that women face in their lives. I don't know. I just feel like they're more innately connected to what we always felt dramatic films were about, which is hard choices in life, you know, real tough choices that we all make. And usually the domestic stories are women's stories. And so I've always been drawn to them, and I've been drawn to directors who have also been drawn to them, and they've inspired me and informed my work tremendously. But my relationships with great actresses has also just deepened my own craft. And I think, made each of those films unique and specific for what they were trying to do, largely because of those amazing women.
How collaborative is your relationship with, so just with this example here with Julianne Moore, it's such a visceral sequence. It's not on the page. How do you get there?
I do think it takes extraordinary. I mean, with the role of Carol White in Safe, which is kind of on a class unto itself in the challenge that one might
Absolutely.
Bring to an actor. You know, she read the script before I can't remember if I'd seen Shortcuts. Or she read the script first, or whatever the order was. But she was new on the block, and people didn't really know her work. She was sort of an emerging name. But she read the script, and she connected to it, and she really understood it. And she heard where the voice needed to sit, and I think she found the body of the character, which is a vanishing body, a diminishing body, right in front of your eyes as you watch that film unfold. And, you know, Julianne is fearless, and she's not necessarily, if anything, you know, this whole adage of, you know, I want to play strong women, and I don't think she wants to play strong women. I think she's interested in playing women who confront life and who struggle. And I think you know, this particular role was a challenge, but also something that you just didn't, there were no real examples of that as a central character in a movie. If anything, it was a challenge to the identification, you know, of every viewer. And that was part of what I was interested in doing in that film. But it took an actor to meet that challenge on the other end and to be a real person, mm-hmm. you know, on that, in that story. So I've been very lucky.
So why do you think, I mean, it is obvious, you know, just based on when the award season happens every year and that there are just so many roles created for men, and, you know, this incredible machine of filmmaking just isn't taking advantage of both these actresses and the opportunities that you're talking about. I mean, is there an explanation for it? People seem to like to go to see movies that feature, you know, interesting women characters in the center.
It always feels like this short-term cycle of amnesia where we keep forgetting that there's a female audience out there. Their films about women have been successful. And when they are, everyone's like, oh my God, let's, you know, make another movie about women, you know, like it's some bizarre new discovery. And it's, you know, it's frustrating if not angering, I think, you know, because there are just so many stories to tell. I mean, a lot of it has to do with just how the nature of dramatic films, period. How people don't necessarily go out to the theaters to see them as much. They see spectacle films, they see special effects movies. And so they don't get the same studio incentive for financing. And we look at cable and other venues for maybe, you know, telling these stories. So it's not, you know, but yes, there's a narrowing down of that model of what the movie-going, you know, target audience is, and remains that 21-year-old adolescent boy, you know. And unfortunately, the results are in the films that get made.
The good news is, of course, that creates ongoing space for you to create your work and for it to be celebrated, which is great.
As long as I have Christine Vachon by my side to fight the battle,
Todd's longtime producer,
my longtime
Christine.
Producer, yeah. Who is indomitable and fearless, and will, yeah, I mean, really safe. Took us, I don't know, 4 years to get financed.
Wow.
It was a tough sell,
yeah.
As you can imagine. And there were many times where I just said, you know, Christine, I want to do this movie, but I don't know if I have the fight to keep going back. And she said, we're going to do this movie. And we did.
The importance of partnership. We're going to move on to the next phase of your work. It's kind of an unlikely trio. I don't know if people group them ever, but I decided that we'd try it out tonight. This idea of creating your own identity, either being forced into having to find an identity for yourself, or having the sort of self-consciousness to do so, really seems to run like a thread through these three films, if not through all your work. I kind of like these three because they all sort of use a lens or a kind of a prism of history, historical period, and historical figures, especially, mm-hmm. Which kind of almost seems to really emphasize the sort of journey that you actually want to take these characters on, because they're somehow familiar to us. So if we could roll clips of Velvet Goldmine, Far From Heaven, and I'm Not There, please.
Now at that time, Kurt Wilde was between management, and Brian knew this, of course, and urged Divine to pursue the situation.
And so if in that probability an interest arose in which Brian would serve on some projects, possibly, though not exclusively, as we're taking our lead from you here, Kurt, possibly as a producer on that project, how might that scenario, purely hypothetically, how might that scenario appeal to you at this juncture?
What Jerry's trying to say is, do you want to come to London to cut a record?
Oh, yeah, cool.
Very good.
But how can we help you? You must tell us. What do you need?
Everything. See, Harold was my main man. But now I'm on the methadone and I'm getting my act together. And you come here and say you want to help. And I say, hey, far out. you could be my main man.
It was pretty clear what was happening. It happens every day. But for the world to think it was happening, well, that was Jerry's particular genius. Right away, he started promoting the two of them like a pair of 40 starlets on a swoon. Tracy and Hepburn for the 70s. Satellite of love.
Frank, you never had that physical. I think you're due for one. Can I call Dr. Ellis? You know, it's been 3 years. What did I tell you? That the pediatrician thinks that Janice is going to need braces.
Father, do I have to?
Apparently our little girl has an overbite.
Pop, you'll never guess what I'm doing.
David, where is your coat?
It's in the garage.
And what's it doing there?
I'm waxing Pop's car. It's gonna look swell, Pop.
How many times do I have to tell you, children, you are not permitted outdoors in this kind of weather unless you're properly dressed?
Yes, ma'am.
Because I give up. If you want to go and catch your death of cold, then so be it. You try talking some sense into them, Frank, because whatever I say doesn't... Frank. What's the matter? David, Janice, go upstairs to your rooms. Now! Now!
Fallen in love with someone who wants to be with me. Kathy. I never knew what that felt. But I know that sounds so cruel, but oh God, Kathy, I tried. I tried so hard to make it go away. And I thought that I could do it for you and for the kids. But I can't. I can't. I can't.
I assume then you'll be wanting a divorce.
Sound very tired, very ill. Is this your normal state?
I take that as an insult.
Do you suffer from sore eyes, groovy foreheads, and curly hair? Take Zumdum.
Hey, isn't that what's his name? The poet Ginsberg.
Allen Ginsberg. Oh my God, it is.
Where, man?
Alan thought that was you in there. I don't think you two have met.
Hi.
Hey. Alan, tell them what you said to that reporter, the one that asked if you thought that Jude had sold out.
Well, they're asking you.
I said, I didn't know. Perhaps you sold out to God.
What does that even mean?
Well, if your mission was to see whether you could do great art on a jukebox, well, you know, then we all benefited.
Profited, you said, by his coercion.
That was it. So, what now?
Now,
way.
Let's left.
Oh, my salvation.
Well, see what we can do.
Oh, he'll give it to you.
It was Allen Ginsberg, man.
See you later, Allen Ginsberg.
It's a Douglas Sirk sandwich with rock and roll bread. So, let's start with Velvet Goldmine. I have a very strong personal affinity for the movie. Part of it is growing up listening to that music and sort of being inspired by the really kind of radical position that a lot of those figures, David Bowie and the late great Lou Reed, you know, in terms of sort of gender and sexuality and just, you know, screw it, you know, with society as a whole in terms of how they actually were taking their place. The interesting thing about Velvet Goldmine, I didn't pick up a clip for that that illustrated this, but it's actually, interestingly, it's the only film of yours that has a structure where you have someone going back to try and learn from people. And there's this explicit thing where this journalist really wants to learn from these figures who are kind of these media, you know, as the aesthetics of the movie sort of show, they sort of live in this sort of poetic dream, druggy, like, kind of, you know, kind of non-linear life. What do we have to learn from characters like that, from people like Iggy Pop and David Bowie and the sort of gender knots of the 70s?
Everything. I still kind of can't believe that moment happened the way you, as you described it. And that's why I wanted to make a movie about it. And it really was this cultural blip. It was this sort of accident of popular art, where, and yet, of course, there were the outgrowth of questions about sexual liberation and sexual identity were coming out of the late 60s and maybe needed to reach this particular kind of fruition in the early 70s. But I do think that there's something still challenging about it, and particularly due to the fact that it's really about this mutability. It's about this, androgynous, bisexual imagination. And today, in our very tolerant, fully accepting America around gay identity, almost nearly fully
except
tolerant.
Except Eastern Kentucky, maybe not so much. But.
We still need that, man. That, you know, all too often what you hear is a kind of like a reaffirmation of settled identities on each side of the sexual equation. That basically we will, a born that way, what it means of accepting heterosexuality, homosexuality. But as soon as you start to talk about the instability that bisexuality suggests, all kinds of, everything goes up in the air, because all of the legislative arguments for he didn't choose his sexuality, he was born that way, become problematized in really interesting ways. You know, I'm not so sure that sexuality is ever entirely a genetic choice. I think it's a combination of all kinds of factors, and that we always make choices. You know, in our lives, we always choose who we're ultimately going to be with if we're going to be with somebody. And for a bisexual person, they're still deciding to be with, often, one person at a time and one sex at a time. And so even that is a choice, but it comes out of a sense of, a different orientation that's mutable. And so that period was irresistible for so many reasons. And that's also why it made so much sense as a moment in rock music, because it spoke to the instability of young people who are figuring out who they are every day. And so the idea of dressing yourself up as one thing one day and something else the next made sense to young people. And the idea of the alien, the extraterrestrial, as a symbol that Bowie incorporated as well into the whole notion of sexual ambivalence made sense to young people. So all of that was a really radical, fertile, destabilizing time, you know? So for so many, and it also became a really wonderful opportunity to play with notions of the natural and invert them, and to use Oscar Wilde as the patron saint of this very long and complicated history of queer history and art making and expression, you know? And so it's all in Velvet Goldmine in a sort of concise package. But what it also did, and why the young person who you're talking, referring to, played by Christian Bale, the journalist, excuse me, I'm having a Marco Rubio night where I can't get enough water. That's because I'm coming out of a cold. But it also gave the fan a role to play. So the spectator became activated. It became active, you know, and an active participant. And so it was necessary that I sort of mock or make reference to the Citizen Kane structure, where we're going to look back and discover who these titans of the glam era were through the journalist structure of Citizen Kane. But in this case, instead of it being the silhouetted guy who you never know, the spotlight ultimately turns on that character, because in the glam era, the fan was also endowed with a tremendous role.
And power.
And power. Yeah. And an interaction with his desires and his fantasies. And so it was really it's a fan's story, ultimately. And that's why you and I can relate to it. It's not really from the point of view of the rock stars.
So the characters in Far From Heaven, of course, shapeshift almost as aggressively, but they don't see themselves having the same kinds of choices. You know, Dennis Quaid finally comes to the realization that he's gay, moves in with his lover. Julianne Moore has to deal with that fact, you know, begins an affair with her black gardener, who also has to confront his own social position. The pieces are all moving throughout the whole time. This is the, well, I think that you've been talking about and we've been referencing Golden Age Hollywood throughout our talk so far. It's really the moment where you sort of explicitly go there, you know,
yeah.
And you kind of live in that moment, and particularly, you know, sort of thinking through the legacy of the great Douglas Sirk and All That Heavens Allows in particular. But I think all of his films play many of his films play a role in the construction of the movie. And then since then, that's actually been a really interesting period for you. The sort of the entrapment, but also the opportunity, the thinking about liberation, was sort of inherent and sort of the tension during that 1940s, 1950s, early 60s period in the United States. What is it that really draws you to that? And what is it, both from a sort of period time and the kind of very precise production design and costume design, which has, of course, been, you know, for this film and for many others, been celebrated with Oscars and such. But this precise look at that time, almost a fetishized look at the period through that lens. Now, the other side, the filmmakers themselves and their importance to you. I'm going to talk about that a little bit.
Well, it is hard for me to put Far From Heaven in the same discussion of sort of options for identity and options for sexual.
I was pushing it a bit.
As Velvet Goldmine or certainly for I'm Not There. But people do ask me a lot about Far From Heaven in relationship to this new film, Carol. They're both set in the 50s. The thing is that they are at very different ends of the 1950s. And that did interest me a lot, and so they look and feel quite different to me, and that was the intention in the design and the strategy of how to visualize that both films. Both were shot by Ed Lockman, but we had very different strategies going in to the two films. And, you know, yes, I was very interested in a sort of series of repressive models that we attribute to the 50s that are evident and played out so consummately in Cirque's films. And we can talk about Carol maybe separately, sure. Because I do think it's a specific thing. Carol to me is like a love story. And so point of view is very important to how that film functions in my mind. And what's interesting about Cirque's films is they're not subjective, they're descriptive. So you are watching, he once said something like, you can't make films about things, you can make films with things. People, light, flowers, mirrors. And what I think he was saying is that you can't have an agenda. That what he tried very much to do was to show you the world in very fixed, rigid terms and watch people moving around in their world, facing certain kinds of pressures in their lives. And in many cases, buckling under those pressures and having to make choices that aren't always heroic, or actually almost never are heroic. They almost always end up smaller versions of who they are at the beginning of the movie. And so his angles always include the person being spoken to in the frame. Rarely does Jane Wyman own her own angles in the movie. She does not have that agency as a subject in his films. And that's why everyone talks about those decors and that are so immaculate and enameled and oppressive and claustrophobic, and they bear down on the freedoms of these people. And they delimit what's possible for them to do about their desires. And with Far From Heaven, I really tried to sort of tell a story without a villain, where a lot kind of entanglement of three characters would simply show one person moving ever so slightly toward their needs, and it would create a kind of web of effects on all three of them that would be an entanglement and ultimately a knot. And while the experience of the black man in 1950s Connecticut is different from the experience of the closeted white gay man and is different from the white woman, these various forms of oppression are comparable. And ultimately, in some ways, the woman holds, you know, the most burden. Interestingly enough, the white man can move around in hiding, you know. The black man is all too visible, so it's overdetermined what his options are. The woman ends up bearing the weight of the institution, the family, and the home, and the child, the children. So, those were what motivated the
Fantastic.
Movie.
So back to the rock and roll. for those of you who've seen I'm Not There, it's impossibly freewheeling. You know, seven different actors portraying a Dylan-esque character who's really Bob Dylan. In many ways, it's sort of you're using an enormous range of tools as a filmmaker and really, really broadening your canvas. Particularly after Far From Heaven, which you know has this very kind of, you know, purposely constricted environment around it, and many people have written about the push-pull of the two movies and how interesting it is for an artist to actually do that, sort of break out of that box. I was more interested in the sort of idea of this broad canvas and what kind of, you know, obviously the story and what you wanted to tell drove it, but how much fun were you having? Were there learnings that you had as an artist in playing on such a wide, big field?
Yes, absolutely. It was an exhilarating, challenging. I mean, it was like, you know, giving yourself the best assignment or or the best thesis project or the best doctoral thesis you could do, which was to try to, you know, personify the multifaceted characteristic of this very unique protean artist from the 60s. And or at least I felt that when I started to read, I was into Dylan in high school, and then I kind of lost track of him, and I found myself coming back to his music in the end of the 90s, almost out of a necessity to return to some of that kind of adolescent energy that I had first associated with him in my life, to move me to a different place in my life, which I didn't even really know I was doing until I did it, you know? And he became the conveyor. And I started to read all these biographies about Dylan and discovering a lot of the bootleg stuff that was just starting to get released. And the biographies just kept saying the same thing, which was, we all knew about, you know, him plugging in electric and, you know, horrifying or disappointing the betrayed, the feeling, the folk followers who felt so betrayed by that change, or him becoming a Christian, you know. But what you saw on even a almost monthly basis was a kind of, you know, shape-shifting, an insatiable hunger to absorb the cultural stimulus that was in the air at this time in the village in New York in the early 60s, and have it completely change and motivate that new phase that he would enter, and then he would discard it and move on to something else. So all of these changes became habitual, and you saw it not just as a practice, or as, it wasn't just like some little rebellious, you know, bratty guy that we see in Don't Look Back, perhaps, you know. It wasn't just some like aspect of a, you know, feisty, ornery personality. It was a survival mechanism for somebody who was fundamentally a creative creature, who was found himself at that center of such attention in this decade, that the expectations for what he would do next and the desire for it to resemble what he had done before was so great that it was ultimately stifling to this creative being. And he almost needed to violently kill off what that was each time. And so it was such a great opportunity to say, okay, let's split him up into characters.
Right.
And not just that, but as a filmmaker, let's allow each of those stories to bear the stylistic language of cinema from the 60s that was relevant to that character and what he was doing, you know? So that's where, but really I have to say, all of that really happened so much in the planning stage, like the writing and the, you know, the research and the, you know, I get very obsessive with my little image books. And so the Dylan one, the I'm Not There one, is so, you know, meticulous and crazy. And it's beautiful. It's fun to look at. It's really, you know, it reflects even just at a visual language, at a graphic level, what you feel in the narrative components of each of the stories. So that was just exhilarating. But I felt that, yeah, sure, this career does not die, Bob Dylan's. But I felt, let's at least just focus on the 60s. That era was one that so produced him and that he so maybe in part produced as well. And it sort of showed the roots of so many of the sort of core themes that he would return to even later when he'd go back to traditional roots music. He had started doing that in the 60s, you know. So all of the themes were rooted in that very rich era, and very rich era for visual experimentation and cinematic experimentation.
So let's take a look at the last two clips now. These are, of course, your two most recent works. We're going to take another look at Carol for a second one coming out in November. November 20th. I had the opportunity to see it at the Telluride Film Festival. It's a remarkable work and will certainly be part of the conversation of the awards season, so run, don't walk. And before that, very, very interesting, interesting parallels with Carol, of course, and Far From Heaven, your adaptation of Mildred Pierce for HBO and a five-hour miniseries that was much praised and won you several nominations and Kate Winslet a great number of awards. Let's roll some clips.
How do you do? I'm Mrs. Forrester. How do you do? It's customary, Mildred, for the servant to sit on the mistress's invitation, not on her own initiative. It's perfectly all right. But on little things, especially with an experienced woman, I find it well to begin at the beginning. Do sit down. We've many things to talk about. It'll make me quite uncomfortable to have you standing there.
This is all right.
Mildred, I invited you to sit down.
What's your name?
Therese.
Therese Balivant.
And yours?
Carol.
The night is like a lovely tune. Beware, my foolish heart. But should our eager lips combine, then let the fire start. For this time, it isn't fascination. It's love, this time it's love, my foolish heart.
Good trailer. That sell you? So. I want to get to the audience, so just a quick one on this. I mean, I don't want to push it too far, but this idea of this through line from Far From Heaven into Mildred Pierce and into Carol, obviously very different films, but again, sort of like returning to this period and its importance. What's been your evolution as an artist through those very different projects to sort of get to Carol and its, you know, its very, very particular romanticism?
In you know, with both Carol and with Mildred Pierce, which were adapted from novels, I think for me it was coming to naturalism, which when you really look at all the other films, they almost none of them engage in.
Yep.
And you know, I've always had my I don't really believe in realism in movies. I don't really think of movies as I'm really interested in the way what's real about films is what we bring to them, not what they give to us. And so so I in some ways I've it's taken a long time for me to get to this more restrained you know, stylistic tradition. Which is a rich one and a nuanced one. It's not like there's one kind of naturalism or one kind of realism. And I don't even know if I would call Mildred Pierce or Carol realistic films. They have very specific moods that they set up. But with Carol, really for me, I read the script and I read the beautiful Phyllis Notch's beautiful adaptation and the amazing Patricia Highsmith novel it was based on, Price of Salt. And I was like, this is a love story. And I've never really done a love story before. And that was like a great, I was like, wow, I want to watch a lot of love stories and see how they work. And it made me think a lot about point of view, as I mentioned earlier, and subjectivity, and how the great love stories, you're always kind of on the side of the more vulnerable party. And what was interesting about Carol is how that changes as it can in life from one party to the other. And so that was a great way to kind of enter it from narrative strategy point of reference. And but yeah, it was a great experience. It was just interesting. I'd never done somebody else's script really. I mean, because Mildred Pierce, I read the novel. John and my friend John and Raymond and I said, you got to read the original novel, Mildred Pierce. The recession was just happening. And I said, let's adapt it. Let's do it. Let's do it long form dramatic television and see if we could get a cable company to do it. And HBO said yes. So we really initiated that entire thing. Whereas Carol came to me after a long gestation period. So it was a different way.
Sounds like you're really delighted in that you know. That's
I did.
A,
it was
a liberating process.
It was a faster process. Yeah. It wasn't that long research thing and the slow gestation thing. So, but it was really cool, and everybody involved were really committed. And you know, I think you see it in their work.
It's great. Let's bring up the lights and start to get some audience questions now.
So, questions for Todd Haynes. We'll start right here in the front. Thank you for taking us on this wonderful artistic journey. I also am a big fan of Douglas Sirk. Can you tell me how old you were when you saw Imitation of Life and how it impacted you?
I really didn't discover Sirk. A lot of people I know discovered Sirk on the late night movie, right? Is that your experience? And I kind of wish I had. In my introduction to Sirk was in college. So it was already sort of enshrined in a sort of academic platform that meant this was worth paying attention to and had a kind of intellectual, following or context to look at.
So sort of it was part of like a semiotics?
Well, it was just in college, and it was definitely in relationship to the women's film and film. Feminist film theory classes I was taking and stuff about Fassbender and all of that, but it was sort of cheating, I think.
Next question is over here.
I want to apologize in advance for asking one of those dopey fanboy questions that happen in venues like this, but
it's quite a setup.
Bring it on.
In Safe, when she's moved to the separate village there, and there's that ghostly, super creepy figure in black that moves through the landscape. Is that a real person? Is that a hallucination? Is that a symbol for something that's happening? I can't believe I get to ask you. So I want to know.
Lester is the character's name. No, it's a real guy, and he's talked about in the film. But they discuss the level of extremity of Lester's chemical sensitivity. But I remember, Lester's inspired by a crazy person who would walk up and down Second Avenue when you go to like the Second Avenue deli when it existed. Or no, it was some deli that had a window where you could look out onto the street, maybe Veselka. And this person was completely covered in knitwear and walked like an Egyptian sideways, but looking at you as they walked, but no face, because it was all covered. And it was chilling, and it was when there were a lot more kooks in New York City. But yeah, I just never forgot that image, and I had to put it in Safe.
The next question is here in the middle, right here, middle.
Oh, wow, hi.
Hi.
So Velvet Goldmine, I'm kind of obsessed with the aesthetics because it's so like weird and kind of crazy, but like in a good way. So I was wondering how you kind of came up with that and whether it was like difficult or like more fun and freeing.
Oh, I wish it was more fun. For me, the one thing I have to say that we did really well, for Christine Vachon, my producer and I, It was one of the hardest shoots. We had very little money, super tight schedule. Shot it all in London, which was great. The one thing I have to say is that we made it possible for everybody in the film to have the time of their life. So Christian Bale, on the day of the wrap, he just said, like, I think this was actually really hard for you, Todd, but it was amazing for me. and he cried when he took off his costume for the last time and said goodbye to Arthur Stewart, who was a Mancunian with a perfect Manchester accent. It was such a hard shoot. The one thing that got us through that shoot was the music, because it was all, every time we had to shoot a scene with the music, and everybody would just be so exhausted, and the crew would be so demoralized and so beaten down, and then the music would be pumping through the speakers, and the adrenaline would just sort of be shared around the room, and that made it, yeah. And the music was such a fantastic component of the film, sort of a separate production going on simultaneously with the film itself. So that really got us through.
Next question is right down here in front.
Yep. Yes, Mr. Haynes, there was a discussion earlier tonight about your ability to get great performances from your actresses. And it was stated, or it was hinted, that one of the reasons is because you're able to get visceral performances from your actresses. And that is a very good point. That is very true. And I thought this was illustrated very clearly by the clip from Safe. Not only with respect to Julianne Moore, but with respect to the little girl who was sitting on her lap. This was a scene where this little girl had to convey what you wanted through no dialogue, just through her body language and her facial expressions, and until the end of the scene. And my question to you is, wherever did you find that little actress? How did you coax that type of performance from her, a very difficult material, very demanding material, and has she done anything since Safe?
A star is born.
I know, I wish I knew. That was 1994 when we shot Safe. That was quite a while ago. I don't really remember how we found her, except that I had a fantastic casting director, Jackie Fink, who cast that film out of Los Angeles. But I do know that, actors help each other. And so she was in the company of all of these women that day, and they were eating real cake, and they were eating real ice cream, and there were some ad-libbing going on, which I think always helps with kid performances. And then she had to sit on Julianne's lap on this little sort of, footstool, cushion stool, and hear her gasping for air. And we never really had time to do many, many takes. So the kid was really experiencing what that was like, the discomfort of that as it was happening. And I think that's what you see in the performance. But thank you for taking note of it.
The next question's way up here at the top.
Hi, I've seen about half your movies and they're great, but I wanted to know, how would you handle the casting of Stonewall now that the movie Stonewall, people protesting it?
Oh.
How would you handle that situation prior to knowing this?
I haven't really followed it so closely. What people are saying, it's not a diverse cast, is that?
I think that they sort of recast what was in fact a lot of drag queens of color as being like a revolution led by a young, pretty white boy.
Oh, I don't know, man. That's
not that I have any stake in this.
No, but that's a missed opportunity to not really the people who participated in Stonewall, and some of them are still around, and they can tell you stories. And it was a motley crew. It was a rich, diverse slice of New York City life, and it was boiling over at the end of the 1960s, and they had enough of these fucked up police raids who would go in and, perfunctorily make little examples of bringing queers in every night, And they were just saying enough is enough. And so there was outrage, there was anger, there was fierceness. And to miss that opportunity and not really feel the richness of that culture, I don't know. I haven't seen the movie, so I can't say, but that would be a lost opportunity in my mind.
Next question is way up here in the middle.
Hi, Tom. Todd, my name's Nani. Speaking on diversity, I want to know what's your opinion of the lack of diversity in regards to females, specifically females that aren't portraying a stereotypical role?
I'm sorry, that there isn't a lack of diversity in?
Female diversity in films, and specifically women, ethnic women who aren't playing stereotypical roles, such as the crack addict on welfare or the housemaid.
Well, yes. I mean, I think, obviously, did you see Viola Davis's extraordinary speech on the Emmys? And that's an example. I have to say, I'm behind on a lot of television that I have to watch. But, you know, she is, I think she's playing a detective in that show, right? So she, yeah, I think all you can do is just, and she talked about her, her company of other actresses and how much she's part of this family of actresses and how much they're producing their own work. Maybe they're an elite within a community that needs much more representation and much more diversity in options, but, you know, I can only be heartened when I see stuff like that. Hopefully we'll see more of it.
Our last question's right here.
Hi, can I hold it?
Sorry.
First of all, I want to tell you that I was lucky to distribute Velvet Goldmine in Tel Aviv in Israel, and it was amazing, and we made this amazing glam event there and made all Tel Aviv people glam, and it was really effective in those times. It was a long time ago. I wanted to ask you about Carol and ask you why, if it was a love story between two women, you chose to name the film just of once, and how does it affect the way we're watching the film and watching those two in our point of view?
It's a good question. You know, we weren't, The Price of Salt was a novel, was Patricia Highsmith's second novel right after her first debut novel, which was Strangers on a Train. And it's the only novel that she wrote that was outside the crime milieu that she's known for. And she's a very prolific writer. And it was a lesbian love story, and she was a lesbian in her life. And it drew on her own personal experiences, but her publisher, who had just published, I think it was Harper's, would not touch it. And she shopped it around, nobody wanted to get near it, and then finally a sort of underground publisher decided to publish it under a pseudonym. Her agent said, do not publish it under your name. Alfred Hitchcock just bought your rights to your first novel. You don't want to condemn yourself to this marginal identification. And so the novel became a very well-known novel within lesbian circles during her lifetime. While she was still alive in the 1980s, it was published as Carol and under her name. And so I think, I'm not sure if it was an English publisher, I think it was the English title. And so when I received the adaptation, it was called Carol. I loved the title, The Price of Salt. It was evocative, mysterious. I think people still argue about what it really means, The Price of Salt. But I think we ultimately felt that it was maybe slightly prosaic for the film. And Carol, the reason why it's called Carol is because Carol is really the object of desire in the story. And it's the novel, The Price of Salt, is locked into the subjectivity of the younger woman who Rooney Mara plays in the film. And Carol is this older woman who's struggling through her marriage with a daughter who lives a comfortable life in New Jersey. What was I saying? Oh yeah. But the object of desire is the woman who is 15 years older than this young girl of in her early 20s. And I love that about it. I thought that was really interesting, that the older woman is the object. And there's an element of sort of something aloof about her, something neurotic about her, something unsettled about her, that puts Therese and this new, these new feelings that she doesn't even have words for on edge throughout much of the film. That relationship of who's the object and who's the subject does shift in the story. But it made sense, ultimately, that that would be the name for the film.
So I know you'll all be rushing to Carol as soon as it opens here. I want to thank you all for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Thanks, Noah Cowan. Thank you, Todd Haynes.